Rajeev Bhai setting up the Vinayatan YouTube channel that you might have just seen. It's fairly new, and they are adding some really nice quality videos on there. Most of them are in Hindi, but some have got tough subtitles. I would really recommend that you sign up to that YouTube channel. It's really wonderful.
Good evening, everyone. So I think today's lecture is on the Samayika Sutras. I think you have already covered the no commentary. So today we will look at the Panchindiya Sutra. So the Panchindiya Sutra, as you very much know, if you recently done the Pratikaman, that as soon as we do Samayika, that's after the no commentary, the Panchindiya Sutra is recited. So not only during when you do Pratikaman, but even during initiation of Samayika, if people want to sit for 14 minutes of Samayika, the first thing which is recited is the Panchindiya Sutra. And essentially it is known as the Guru Gun Smaran Sutra. So Guru na Gun, the qualities of the Guru are summarized in the Sutra. So Sutra means venerating Guru's qualities. So I think some of these sutras, the intention is that it would be nice for people to actually learn the sutras themselves. And what we can do is actually, it's a pretty short prayer, and we can actually recite it together. And so that gives you an opportunity that if you want to practice this by yourself, then you can understand how to pronounce it. Now, if you see that even this occurs during the Pratikaman, when some of the sutras are presented on the slides, it's hard to understand what the English translation means. So when you look at Panchindriya, so whenever they say A, and where there's got a line on top, that's A, Panchin A. So otherwise it's very difficult to see. So like if let's just see, Panchindriya Sambaranam. So Panchindriya Sambaranam. So there's an emphasis on the Ma. And then, so Kasai. So otherwise it's not known whether it's Sa or Sa. So when there's a line on top, that becomes Sa, Kasai. Otherwise, if it's just K-A, that's like just K. So, Kasaya Mukko. Iya Attharasa A. So, that A with the line on top becomes like an A. A. And so I think that's, it's nice to know, otherwise you know from what it says, Pancha or Pancha. So, if you literally go and recite the sutra, so it's Panchindiya. So if you just want to repeat after me, Panchindiya. Samvarano Taha Nava Viha Bambhachara Uttidharo Chau Viha Kasaya Mukko Iya Atharasa Gunehin Sanjutto Pancha Mahavaya Chutto Pancha Vihayara Palana Samatto Pancha Samiyo Tikutto Chattisa Guno Guru Majja. Again, if you just see that if you actually use Gujarati, then it's Chattisa. So it's not Chattisa, Chattisa. It's double ta. So that makes it, there's actually more emphasis on the ta. Chattisa, Guna, Guru, Majja. So sometimes you actually can understand the language, it actually makes it much more easier to understand how to pronounce it. Where there's an emphasis, where there's a na, where there's an ana. And so that becomes. Then the next, so it's literally a very short prayer, and it's kind of amazing to see that Acharya Chandani's guru, Amar Muni Maharaj, Upadhyaya Amar Muni Maharaj, he's actually written extensively on just these two verses. And it's kind of amazing that once we get into the depths of the prayers, how much depth and profoundness there is in this. So let's understand what this prayer is about. So the verse says, one who has controlled the five senses, and practitioner of the ninefold restraints of celibacy. So this is giving the qualities of a guru. So guru is a person who is controlled the five senses. They are practitioners of the ninefold of the celibacy. They are free from the fourfold passions. So krodh, man, maya, lobh. So these are the four passions. So they are free from this. So that makes it 5 + 4 = 9. 9 + 9 = 18. So those are the 18 qualities mentioned there. Then the upholder of the five major virtues, Mahavrats. So we follow the Anuvrats and the sadhus, they follow the Mahavrats. They are completely practicing the fivefold conduct, Samiti, which is known as fivefold conduct, and practitioners of the fivefold regulations and threefold restraints. So if you can get up, the other ones are 5 plus 5 is 10, 10 plus 5 is 15, plus 3 is 18, so 18 and 18 is 36. So they are upholders of these 36 qualities. So it's giving, so when we go through the sutras, we actually understand what these 36 qualities are. And it's also quite interesting to know that if you actually go, some of these, many of these Samayika sutras are available, but you actually go by word, there's a translation in English or word by word. So people were quite interested to understand. So whether it's a logos, whether it's upasatram, many of these sutras, there's actually a word to word translation, and you actually can learn it yourself. It's almost like artificial intelligence. You understand, and then you can understand, this is what the word means. So many of the times it's kind of self learning. Otherwise, you say, I don't understand this. Even if you just, if this prayer was presented to you, Panchindiya. So it takes a punch, Panchindiya is a punch. Indriya. So you can, and once you do a few times, you yourself can start actually then understanding what the prayer means. Sambarano, taha navabhya, navatinayin, viha pambacharya, brahmacharya. So many of these words, if you know Gujarati, you can start deciphering it yourself, what these words mean. We'll actually look into this further. The first thing is indriya. Indriya means senses. And it's sort of amazing to note that the word, just the word indriya, it's actually equating to what we call the indra, like when we say angels, they are in the heavens. But who is even the master of all the angels, devas and devis? It's the Indra Maharaj. So the kings of all the heavenly bodies is known as the Indra. So it's equating that the senses which we have, they are like absolutely amazing. Can you imagine us without our senses? If one of our senses is actually not functioning, can you imagine the pain? For example, my own Masi, my real Masi, she's totally blind since the age of 20s, early 20s. Even now, it's kind of amazing to see how she sort of manages herself, how she sometimes does cooking by herself, that's totally blind, not being able to see her children, not being able to see her grandchildren, but still the smile on her face. But for us, from the outside, it's kind of amazing to see that just with one sense not functioning, how much problems we have. So whether it's the eye, whether it's the nose, the ears, any of our senses, if you have any pain, we know that if there's any pain, there's a problem with any of our senses, life becomes so difficult. So our senses are actually they're so integral to part of our living. So indriya, that's how it's called, indriya. And if you look through how they describe, the indriyas have got 23 functions. And it's kind of amazing to see that how our, when they are they are actually explained, that how can these five senses, and how they've actually been expounded into 23 different. So for example, if you look at, we have got five senses, touch, taste, smell, hearing, and sight. Five senses. So touch, how many types of touch can we feel? And it says we can actually have 8 types of touches. So we can actually feel lightness, heaviness, softness, coldness, hotness, oiliness, and dryness. So these are the 8 different kinds of touches which we can sense. 5 objects of rasindriya. So taste could be of 5 kinds. We can know sweetness, sourness, something which is alkaline, bitter, acrid, or by tasting. Smell, it is good smell or bad smell. Chakshindriya, eyes, we can see the 5 primary colors, because all the other colors are a mixture of these 5 primary colors. So essentially, there are 5 different types of colors which we can appreciate. So some of these prayers, it's very difficult to know when they're actually quite composed. So for example, Nokar Mantra. If you look at the inscriptions, the Nokar Mantra, the earliest known inscription says that there are only 5 words. Namo Indra, Namo Siddharam, Namo Ayaryan, Namo Vajjan, Namo Lois of Savanam. So, and that was actually inscribed on a slab of stone which was unearthed. But when exactly when they're composed is very difficult to know. So as we know, that most of our scriptures were actually compiled sort of a few hundred years after Lord Mahavir. So it was an oral tradition, and then all even the Agams themselves were compiled after them. So it was kind of an oral tradition. So when exactly when they were composed, it's difficult to know that this is when it was. So even when people are doing their research,
There are different Acharya Maharajis who have written, so for example, Bhadrabhau. If someone says Bhadrabhau, there's only not one Bhadrabhau. There could have been many Bhadrabhaus. So then it's difficult to know that what's the start of the language. Was it Prakrit or was it Sanskrit? Because it, initially most of them were in Prakrit and then Sanskrit came later on. So by the style of the how it's been composed, people can infer that this must be around this time period. So then Riya. And Brahmacharya, again, is kind of the sexual activities, and then it's described. There are different types, and we will look into it a little bit further. So the first thing says, is this Panchindiya Sutra is actually saying, I'm giving my reverence, I'm bowing down to my guru. So the first thing is that when people are doing bowing down, he's actually saying, I'm taking my head and I'm going to fall at someone's feet. Now that's quite a serious thing. Can you imagine? People are self-esteem. We all have our own self-esteem. And here we are, when you say, I'm now going to be taking my head. Head is kind of something very integral part of our body. It's a seat of learning, it's a seat of mind. And for someone to say, I'm now going to actually bow down my head to someone, it actually gives a sense of, there's someone who is the master and I'm a slave and I'm actually subjugating to that person. Someone is actually slightly better or higher or superior than me. And here I am, going to actually go through this process of actually bowing down my head to someone. Why would someone want to do that? Someone, Acharya Upadhyaya Muni, actually poses that question. Why would you want to say that here I am, I want to bow down my head to a guru? What makes you do so? Why would I want to, it's actually like a humiliation. Why would I want to humiliate myself to actually bow down to someone? And to that even extent, if you look at it, many people actually, even the chando, which is done, the head is got a significant part of our body. So if you look at the Swami Narayans, they got a red chando. If you look at the Tamangeshkar, even when you look at the armies, salute, it goes towards the points towards the head. It's not sort of points of the waist or leg anywhere, it's the head in terms of the salute. So isn't it senseless or humiliating or demeaning for us to stoop or surrender to someone, to a guru? And then the question begs that even if you look at it, and this is quite common to almost all religions, whether it's a Christian faith, whether you look at the Muslim, when they pray to the Namaj, on the prayers, it's actually bowing down. Even when someone wants to propose, they actually want to bow down. So it's kind of so that the feeling of how much reverence, how much feelings you have within you. Even if you look at the yoga, the people say that people have these chakras. And the chakras, it's quite interesting that in the Eastern philosophy it's called chakras. And recent research has shown that these chakras actually even correspond to the endocrine glands of the human body. So, you know, we hear about the thyroid glands and the pineal glands. So if you look at some of this, the research is showing that many of these chakras, which the Eastern philosophy calls chakras, corresponds to the pineal, to the endocrine glands of the body. And the main function of the endocrine glands is kind of controlling our emotions. So it's kind of quite correlated to see that when after yoga, karta, okay, focus on this chakra here, kind of concentrate on that chakra. But from a scientific point of view, is how can I regulate this endocrine glands, the secretions, and you become calmer, you're not arousing yourself. So it's the emotions and the chakras are going hand in hand. And right at the top is the sastra and the agna chakra, right at the top of the head. So head is a supreme center of thought, intellect, and which is symbolized on the forehead. Scriptures have kind of the significance of gurus and praise them with open hearts. So if a lot of scriptures are saying, in the absence of Lord Mahavir, or you know, we don't have any Tirthankas here, so in the absence of any enlightened ones, it is the gurus for us who is actually propagating this religion. So for us, for all intents and purposes, the gurus to us are like gods. So we should cultivate faith and devotion to gurus. So personification of gurus. So gurus sustains our life just as we cannot live without air. It becomes an integral part of our lifestyle. So religious practice begins by worshipping a guru. So who is a true guru? So that really begs the question, who is a true guru? And this is actually setting the precedence of the Panchindiya Sutra. That there are so many people around, how can I actually distinguish if this is a guru or not? How can I really find out, is this person a real guru or not? In fact, it's not very recent. If you looked at a few years ago, there was a controversial Indian spiritual guru who was sentenced to life in prison for murder. If you know, it was Gurmit Ram Rahim Singh, and I think he was in Haryana state. and immediately like millions of followers. And it's literally millions of followers. And some of those followers are obviously very rich. And he was actually then convicted of all these kind of wrong things. So it's all again violence, sort of sexuality, and everything else. And then he's actually right now in prison behind bars. So it's kind of quite amazing to know that it's not just one or two followers. What is it that millions of followers got attracted to him? It begs the question. If you know just a few people, you can understand it's a cult. But to actually draw crowds of millions of people, then it says that he was actually, in fact, he actually even made a movie to show that, look, I'm the savior of the world. Everyone's a problem. So he was kind of very self-centered and sort of a flamboyant guru. So Upadhyaya Muni says that one of the main causes of India's backward status is due to the false godmen. There's so many people who are springing up in India. Guruji, let's start following me. You need a bit of oratory skills, you can speak well, and then a charismatic personality. And you can actually even see that right now. Not gurus, but how many people are saying that they actually take this as a vocation? They're becoming like lifestyle gurus that I'm just preaching. How to lead a good life. So they're just actually having a profession like Oprah Winfrey. Who could have imagined just through the power of speech you could become a billionaire? Just by merely talking. So if you have these kind of skills, it's very easy to attract people. And it's even more so like for our children right now, sometimes you feel, it's not what you know, but it's who you know, how you conduct. If our own experiences at work, rather than your technical knowledge, it's how you actually deal with people, how you can speak with people. Which actually sort of makes you go further. So this sutra summarizes what are the qualities of a true guru. How can I actually find? And a person, Amar says, one of the very simplest criteria is, does the guru have grandeur, rich food, wine, and affairs? So these are the kind of things. Is the person who I'm following, are they actually succumbing to such kind of things? And then it actually makes you wonder that they're preaching certain things, but then are they really, that's kind of the rough benchmark. Only accept those gurus who uphold the 36 qualities enumerated in the sutra. Such gurus are indeed worthy of veneration. So in that case, any person who actually sort of follows these 36 qualities or comes into this, it doesn't matter. Then it doesn't say, okay, it's fine to say, I'm not a guru chair. But if I find another guru who has got the same qualities, I'll still give respect to them. So, Panchindiya Sandarana, this whole, it starts with this. So it really says, the sutra starts with the five senses. So we look at the five senses which we have, and essentially what this says is that Bhaktamara Spotrano Che first Eche, Bhaktamara Pranata Mohi Mani Prabhana, Bhujyottama Dharita Pabatama Vidana. So all of the first sutra of Bhaktamara Sutra says that most of us are in this cycle of sansar, life and death, constant circle of life and death. And most of us, this is happening through lifetimes, not just one reincarnation, birth after birth. So, and in the four gatis, so humans, animals, hellish beings, heavenly bodies, we are constantly in this sansara. And it's only, and why is that? It's because the main reason is because of our senses. That our senses now it's taking over us, and because we are actually slaves to our senses, we actually then sort of succumb to all these other kashais and growth, maya, to satisfy sort of all our senses. And this is quite, it's very common to see. If you look at right throughout history, Ketla the king's hata, mana kingdom joyeche, let's wage a war. Or I actually am in love with a queen of another neighboring state, actually let me go and get her. So you actually fight wars just to win over because of this desire of yours. Or I want to achieve Napoleon, I want to conquer all these things, I want to become master. Look at even the present day, many of these politicians, they just want to succumb. Well, they just wonder how much wealth do you want to accumulate just to last for generations. So it's this constant desire which is actually making us go in these circles. So a true guru is detached from objects that attract or repel the senses. So that's really a starting point. And this is really, if you look at it, the word attract and repel. And therefore, one of the main qualities of a guru is samta bhava. Samta means equanimity. As a favorable situation, fair enough. Adverse situation, samta bhava. So, and that's actually, because for us, it's very difficult. We all sort of are okay with favorable circumstances, but anytime some downward trend comes, we actually get shaken. But to maintain the equanimity, and And that's actually the reason why we meet these are gurus and we actually are worthy of veneration. Ninefold celibacy. Celibacy is easy to practice, for it needs for strong condition, ninefold restraints of mind, which and maya. Nine muktis are prescribed. So we look at this what is celibacy? Celibacy obviously is prescribed, but essentially the wider connotation of celibacy is how can we control our senses. Now, I think one of the things which is not been openly discussed in many of the scriptures is this things about kind of sexuality and in terms of men and women. And as we know that most of our monks and nuns, they have a lifelong vow of celibacy. And that extends to such a great extent that let's look at, they say that nine types. Panchindiya Sutra, Nava Viha, Ambhacheno. Nine types. Nava Viha, Viha means types. Nava Viha, Ambhacheno. So they actually practice nine types of celibacy. And these are the kind of nine types. Solitary residence, any location that does not stimulate senses or arouse sensual desires. So they want to stay away from, even if Upashayakam hoi, Sattamara Zakta hoi, so the male is not judas and the female is not judas. And so they just want to make sure that this any of your senses are not aroused. So that's the solitary residences. Stimulating discussions. Just as the description of chocolates and sweets would activate salivary glands, discussions about gender can stimulate intense sensations. And this is quite common. If you look at it, Abhanana Chopra Hoy, as soon as they come to youth, adolescence, and if you look at what goes on, these are kind of very common topics which youngsters and the teenagers would talk about. Kind of, and it's kind of even surprising that it does not even end there. If you look at the society we live in right now, that many of these things happen at such an old age. If you even look at what's happening our prime ministers right now, it's all about allegations of kind of things which they've done in their past in their youth. And right from whether it's whether it's Boris Johnson or whether it's Trump, and so many leaders are succumbing just because of this kind of things that it makes you wonder that this is things that are in the youth and sometimes even not in the youth but carries on right in the middle age and even their old ages. C. Avoid seats previously occupied by opposite gender for at least 2 hours. Now, this is actually saying that this is actually for the sadhus and sadhvis, you know, to what extent it's applicable to us is not, it's not for our lady, it's for the sadhus and sadhvis. And what's the rationale behind this? As I was thinking about this, if you look at science, if you look at a magnet, so if there's a magnet, and this is what the experiments you did in school. So you have a magnet and you put your iron filings around it, what will you see? If there's a north pole and a south pole, you'll actually see the patterns of the magnetic flux going all around it. So we all know that I can see a magnet, but I cannot see the flux around it. It's only when I put iron filings around it, I can now see, I can visualize it. Same thing with this. So our scriptures really believe in certain things that there's energy around us. I cannot see energy, but you can feel the energy around us. So if you were seeking, if there were certain, if I'm sitting here right now, and I've got certain vibrations, so those vibrations are permeating around me. So if I move away, if someone else comes in this, there's a possibility that those vibrations can actually affect you. So that's actually trying to say that, avoid seeing this for at least 2 hours. Now, why 2 hours, not 1 hour, why 3 hours, I'm not sure why that. But, you know, it must be that, you know, the effect of those vibrations then get reduced after a certain time. So that's one of the reasons why when they say that the monks and nuns would like to sort of avoid seats previously occupied by the opposite gender. Sight. Avoid looking at bodily parts of the opposite gender. Now it's quite easy to know that if you look at the sun, we know it blinds us. So that's a physical thing. We know if I look at it on a glaring sun, it's literally going to blind each one of us. So that's on a bodily part. The same thing which is happening is saying is if I'm going to be using my senses to sort of and get stimulated and going to affect my soul, then it's actually you're harming your soul by looking at it, and then therefore you're getting into a different frame of mind. So it's exactly the same, they're trying to focus, and that's why it says restraint. I mean, the direct mind is a restraint, whether it's a sight, whether it's a taste, whether it's a smell, ears, music, samarocho, all these things are senses, and the whole essence is, how can I restrain so that I don't go astray? That any of these senses don't take me. Some people, they say, oh, how am I? And these are kind of quite amazing. I was just speaking to my mother the other day, that one of their very close friends is in his 70s. He's got severe diabetes problems. He's got a fracture. He's been in the ICU, but he just cannot give up the smoking cigarette. To that extent that he's even sort of fallen down. And he's got almost like a 24-hour nurse looking after him, but still needs a cigarette coming in. He says, this is it. His dependency is negative. It doesn't matter. He says, if I haven't got a few hours or a few months to live, I need this. And then the family is just saying, fair enough, if that's what his desire is, so be it. That if he's even got limited time, lifespan, let him be happy with it. So he can get so used to this, some of these senses that it's amazing that it's restraint of the senses. Avoid reciting close to the couples, energies, how does fire melt the wax? If one has taken a certain path, then there is no point sort of saying that any situation can arouse you. So we know that we are very firm vegetarians. So if you pass by a butcher shop, are we going to get any temptation? Oh, I wish I'm a meat house. So we know that that's such a strong conviction within us that that's not going to sway us. But if you've got a weakness within us, then you can say, I'm a sweet spoke bhavish, I'm an abo bhavish. Then it's it. So these are kind of things that, if you are residing close to the couples, then, if there was a fire and there's a wax, the wax is going to melt. So you want to avoid, unless you become such strong in your willpower that nothing affects you, then in a way nothing of this affects you. So it depends on what weaknesses are, and some of these things are very internal. This cannot be observed. Memory of previous indulgence. After taking the vow of celibacy, forget about carnal pleasures. Memory can destroy sadhana, fear of intoxication due to memory. So, because it's quite obvious that many of these sadhu maharajis, they could have been married, and then they could have then decided, now I want to become a monk. So then the idea is to then try to forget all these kind of so-called carnal pleasures which they had in their household life before. Circulated foods. Well known that certain foods can have certain effects on the body. And this is kind of the whole essence of the Ayurveda. That rajasic food, sattvic food and tamasic food. Certain foods are known to have certain effects on the body. Onions, mokhai, affect amthase. Potatoes, amthase, affect amthase. So many of the foods we know can have certain effects on the body. So the idea is that you should, once when you know that, then you know, okay, what kind of foods to eat, when and in what quantities. Excess food creates physical lethargy and mental turmoil. This is what we all experience that. Both heavy khadu hoya jay, jaman war thay yoye, wo bhaiwa yaar ba khani da hoye, we know that, we beta chay, we can't do anything. So and that's one of the essences of apne tap ke ro ke na teo, ke you just want to eat less, and with eat less you actually get more spiritual bigger. And it's kind of amazing to see that even apne position other people being baptized, and kind of seeing the amount of activity, so many of even our SCP volunteers and people were actually being baptized, and thinking, I have given some posters, chairs, books, and others, and kind of thinking, that the energy can tell you, like, we are eating and we're feeling this. In fact, us, the opposite, like, that's not takeaway. We have eaten so much that you actually can't do anything now, we're feeling so heavy. Because they can't come on the chair, but they can't let me just pile up on the vocal food. So you feel exactly like this, you feel very lethargic. Whereas people have eaten less, and they're feeling very, very bigger. So again, this is comes up as a, so as you can see, the celibacy does not just extend on kind of the relationship of opposite gender, but then extends into food. So it just shows that it's all about kind of the senses and adornments. Those that glamorize physical appearance, no body attires and perfumes and everything else, which can actually stimulate your senses. Yeah, any questions? Now, this is a very interesting story. Apne lot of the prayers apne darasama jaye apne bole mangalam bhagwan agiro mangalam gautam prabhu mangalam stuli bhadra jaye jaina dharmos mangal to stuli bhadra jaye. So who is this stuli bhadra jaye? So there was a person named Shaktam, and he had two children, stuli bhadra and Shriya. And Shaktam was actually a minister in King Dhananand's. So he was a minister there. So one of his sons actually then became, his father said, why don't you also join the king and you can become one of the assistants or one of the aides of the king. But Stuli Bhadra, he then actually decided right from a young age, he actually went astray. And right from whatever age, 8, 9, 10, he actually found out that there was actually a prostitute in a neighboring town. And he became actually so enticed with her that he actually decided to leave home, Bhagindya. He left home, and for a good 12 years, he was constantly in the company of a prostitute. And this is very common right now. We could actually find, you know, members of our society who are actually indulging in this kind of activities and sort of totally going astray. Now what happened was King Dhananan actually found out that, and he was, King Dhananan was a very greedy king. He was not a very benevolent or kind king. So one day he actually thought, a lot of people are conspiring against me. They want to really overthrow me. They probably want to kill me. So he says, I really now need to see who all my ministers are and really see if there are any dead thorns within my team. So Shakta, the father, actually found out, okay, the king is actually going to put us to test, and if any of us do fail, then he's got a suspicion on us, on the father and the son. And so he's actually then probably just going to kill us. So then what Shakal then told his son, hey, look, one of us is going to die because the king has got a very strong suspicion on us, and so one of us is going to die. But for you to actually, for the king to get convinced that you are very loyal to him, why don't you just kill me? So the king will actually feel that, look at this guy, he's actually killed his own father, so he's absolutely loyal to me. So he says, oh, this cannot be possible. They say, no, this is fine. And he says, so don't worry, because one of us is going to get killed, because the king has actually got a very strong suspicion and one is going to die. So why would he do, why, to save one of our lives, we do this, that, you know, we just make it so happen that the son has killed the father, and that the king will be absolutely overjoyed. Look at him, he's absolutely loyal to me. He's killed his own father. So what the father did was, let's do this. I want you to get the karma of physically killing me. So I'm actually going to consume poison, and I'll be within you, and then it will just so appear that you've done some activity and you've just killed me. So that's actually what happens. So the father consumes the poison, the father dies, and the king is actually absolutely convinced that, oh wow, look at this Shriya, he's so loyal to me that he actually killed his own father. Now, Sulibhadra actually then finds out that my father has died. And that was a shock in his life. For 12 years, I've not come home, I've not come to see my father, and here is it, my father actually just died. And then his mind became in a state of turmoil, and he says, what is life about? And then this happens many times. Okay, when we go through a crisis, then we start questioning, what is life all about? Otherwise, we are still in a rat race. You always just want to, you know. And because of all this turmoil, he then eventually decided, look, I don't want to, this world is meaningless to me, and I just want to, he went to a Sadhu Maharaj, and he went to Acharya Sambhut Vijay, and say that I actually want to take Diksha. I can actually even imagine one thing. Can you imagine that someone goes to Acharya Sambhut Vijay for the first time, and if someone says, okay, this guy actually was staying in the prostitute for the past 12 years, most of us in the society will actually rebuke him. Ajo Manasche. I mean, what kind of character, what kind of person is he? But can you imagine the foresight of the Acharya Maharaj saying, okay, so that was your past, you stayed 12 years here, and the first time Acharya says, okay, yeah, this was my past, but I now actually want to renounce the world. It is the gurus themselves who can then actually see, is this genuine, and is this person wants to take a reform? Let's give a person a chance. So I think that in itself is a great thing to see. Okay, many people in our society, I am the bankruptcy king, I am the one who I am the. Many of us have actually done things wrong. We could have faltered, but there's a chance to come back and reform our life. And that's kind of amazing to see. And here it is, Acharya Sambhut Vijay, because otherwise on face value, if someone asks for a reference, okay, Amanas, I told you, you literally laugh at him. Oh, Amanas, look at him for the 12 years I know him, what his character is, what is he going to do? So Acharya Sambhut Vijay says, fair enough, okay, you want to become Diksha? Fair enough, okay, but I'm happy with you. And as you all know, that when monks take Diksha, Chomasu is a rainy season in India. In the Chomasama, then they always they stay in one place, and then after Chomasu is over, then they actually go from town to town. So Chomasama, so Acharya Sambhut Vijay, so he had a few disciples, so they all the disciples went to Acharya Shri, and Acharya Shri asked, so Chomasu, where are you going to reside for the next 4 months? So one Sadhu Maharaj says, okay, Guru Maharaj, I'll actually go near Lion's Den. Forest Ma, I'll actually go near a lion's den, I'll meditate there for the 4 months. Lion's Den. So he came, okay, fair enough. It means he came. And can you imagine, compared to Guru Maharaj, even at Upadhyaya Muni, if you actually go to Rajgiri, one of the hills we actually went, in 2011 when we went there, there was a cave there, and he was meditating for many days or months in that cave. And it is, if you ask Rita and Nibbana Pai Maharaj, she can tell you that many times they have known that lions work around that Upadhyaya, and they just go around, they don't do anything. And one of the reasons why that happens is that they have got this universal compassion. They've got such compassion, and that is the really strong conviction. And that's really what drives them forward, saying, because nothing happens for no reason. So if I've got universal compassion towards you, then I've got that such strong conviction to you. I'm not going to do any harm towards you, so you're not going to do any harm towards me. So whether it's a... So one Ajaya said, I'm going to go towards a lion's den. And can you imagine that I'm going to conquer that fear? I've got no fear. The other person said, I'm actually going to go towards a snake's hole. I'll meditate for 4 months just around there. The other Sadhguru had said, I'll actually go towards a well. Now, I'll actually meditate on the edge of the well. The one concentration is too intense here. I'll need that dhyan or anything. But because if I lose my concentration, then death just before me. I'll just fall down into the well and I'll die. And when he comes to Shri Bhadra, he says, I'll actually go, because the lady he used, the prostitute, was Kosha. He says, I'll actually go to the Kosha's, she had an art gallery. I actually want to go to Kosha's art gallery and I want to meditate there for 4 months. Can you imagine? Now someone can doubt that Abhati memory is much here. He was there for 12 years with this prostitute and he's now saying, he's now become a sadhu and now he actually wants to go back to the same Kosha's art gallery and then meditate. Obviously, if Kosha is there, she'll feed him all the succulent foods, but actually, in the German Karan way, go to the Mari Jasa. And the Acharya thought about it and generally they said, the task to. Fair enough, that's it, my blessings are with you, please go ahead. So after the 4 months are over, they all come back and the Guru Maharaj asks them, so how was your 4 months? So they all say, yeah, I stayed lion's den, snakes, all well. They go to Peru, I was at the Kosha's art gallery and sort of Bharavaj. And then the Guru Maharaj stood up saying, excellent, excellent, excellent. Because the person who I give the utmost credit to is Punipatra. And all the other monks were actually shocked. What are you saying then? I mean, for us it was a question of life and death. What did Sutta have to do? What did he have to do? He was in the luxury of Kosha's palace. All the food was being supplied to him. He had a shelter over his head. So what did he have to do? And the Guru Maharaj says, no. He can get another carnal pleasure, especially even the fact that he was with her for the 12 years and he actually sustained his monkhood. He did not get swayed. Lot of credit to him. To that extent, that one of the Sadhu Maharaj is here, he says, Guru Maharaj, I actually disagree with you, and I don't agree with you. So, next time, why don't you give me that? Guru Maharaj says, okay, fine. You want to do that? You can. So, he actually then, the other Guru Maharaj, and then he goes to another Koshan Adhya Jaiche. Koshan Adhya Jaiche, the Koshan gives him all this fruity and everything. And eventually he gets so enamored with her, he's now thinking, I should just literally give up my monkhood. And literally now stay with him. He can now live with you happily ever after. Kosha then realizes that the previous year, Sutpatra came here and what resolution you had. And he should I be the lady to actually make sure I'm monkhood just because of myself? He says, okay, fine. You're so deeply in love with me. Okay, yeah, I understand. Why don't you do this? Why don't you go to Nepal? Go and get a very diamond studded blanket. And again, when you bring it to me, I will know that you are very deeply in love with me, and again, I'll let me marry you. So the Sadhu Maharaj says, okay, fine. So he's now breaking his vow, and he's actually saying, because they're not supposed to travel. So during the Chamasu, he actually goes to Nepal. He then somehow, because they don't have any money, somehow, whatever he does, he manages to convince some people, and he actually gets this diamond studded blanket, and comes all the way back to Kosha's place, and says, Kosha, here, I managed to get this diamond studded blanket for you. She gets it, she's very happy with it. She wipes her feet on that blanket and just throws it out of the all around. What are you doing? You know what the troubles I went to get through this? I traveled all the way to Nepal, I managed to get this, and you just bring it in just like this. Just for the sake of spending time with me, you want to relinquish all these things? And then he realizes. take a word falling, word flowing. He then goes back to the Guru Maharaj, and then Guru Maharaj asks, how was your Guru? He confesses, I did not have the resolution with Stulikotari. I actually sort of succumbed to this, but eventually those Gosha who taught me a lesson and then put me back on earth. So I think the moral of the story really shows that to what extent our senses can sway us. And us, even us as lay people, no one is aware that we can really bind anyone. So I think it's a great story to see how we need to restrain our senses in this. Four passions, kashai. It's amazing the word kashai. And the beauty, one of the beauties of our Sanskrit language is the roots of the words, which is etymology. How does the word kashai come from? Kash, I. Kash means world, sun, world. And I, A-Y-A-I, means prophet. So what is kashai? A prophet for us to be in the world. Kash, I. So the kash actually means world. I means prophet. That means I'll just keep on being born in this universe. Whether it's an animal, whether it's a plant, humans, anything. But the fact is, I'm just getting profit. I'm getting profits being in this circle of life and death, life and death. I'm not getting liberation. So kash I, it's a profit, but profit in the universe is not profit in liberation. It's a beautiful I. And up into it, paisa aiva. Can you even say minus paisa aiva, profit? So even you can see that word I actually does mean profit. So four questions. So we looked at these nine senses. Now we're looking at four kashaya. Chaya kashaya mukho. So the mukho means they are away from these four passions. And the four passions are krodh, man, maya, love. So krodh. Krodh destroys love. Anger destroys love and overcome by forgiveness. When you start forgiving people, you overcome. So it's kind of antidote, the opposite. Black to opposite is white. So most of these kashayas have got there. So if you really want to work on your anger, then it says you start more by forgiving people. Pride destroys modesty and it's overcome by humility. And it's just kind of amazing to see, generally many of us can even get subtle of pride. But if you look around, pride, generally there's no need for us to have any pride. Kani ra apna ko to kitlo educated chu mai pas aati degree che maniya bhayo to aap the university ma gyo to but look at it on recently if you look at it virayat ma there's this young kids in Nepal in a che they can recite the whole Upadhyaya sutra in and out tame ne pucho 46 verse and then they showed a video some time ago. So if you say mai pas aapne knowledge che but look at this other kind of person, he's got so much more knowledge than I. What am I going to feel proud about? So whether it's pride about money, or whether it's pride about knowledge, or about anything, you can always find people who are superior than you are. And so therefore he actually says that there is no need for me to have any pride. Deceit, maya, destroys friendship and overcome by simplicity. And greed destroys all qualities. It's the most dangerous. So achalmatikeche is a greed, is supposed to be the king of all the passions, greed. It destroys all the qualities. Amato amu qualities che. Anger can destroy love. But greed ekoravidyo. But all qualities are nullified. And therefore, overcome by contentment. So, the five great vows. Pancha Mahavriya Chutto. So, they are the ones who uphold the five great vows. The five great vows, Mahavrats, Ahimsa, Satya, Asteya, Brahmacharya, and Aparigraha. They can say Aparigraha. So there was a greed. Chakra Ochu contains type of simplicity. Ahimsa avoids violence of mind, vachan, kaya towards all creatures. So Ahimsa means I don't want to have any violence by mind, by speech, or by bodily towards all creatures. And that also is resonates very good. Pratikavanma, Satlak, Adharpap, Avesh, Adharpap, Adharpap, Sana, Pele, Pranathipat. So the first thing is Pele Pranathipat. So these are the kind of the first violence which people can do. Pranathipat. Violence is actually equated to pran. So you can actually, when I say I've done some violence to someone, what kind of violence can you do? It's a pran. And the prans are, the five senses are the pran. So that's what happens. Like for example, when someone says I'm going to shoot him, there are certain centers of our body which are in concentration of pran. So for example, heart. Breathing. So these are certain centers of our body where prana is actually concentrated. You actually destroy that prana, Prana means that the flow of energy to destroy our livelihood. So therefore, after going to the bhave, if I cannot breathe, then the prana goes away, so then you lose your life. So prana has five senses: man, vachan, nikaya, breath, and longevity. So these are the kind of the 10 pranas which we have. So if prana is going for things, hinsa ke, so then becomes violence. If I'm actually going to do any violence towards those prana dipat. Vijay Mrushavar. So the Satya is actually called Vijay Mrushavar. Mrusha means untruth and var means argument. All these discussions and it sort of that's violating the flow of Satya. And sometimes it actually makes even me wonder, like look at the modern day profession. If someone is a lawyer is a good profession. But it sometimes makes me wonder, if I went to a lawyer and if I've done something wrong, if the lawyer has to defend me, then and he has to make arguments in court to actually defend the wrong thing, that actually doesn't seem to be quite the right thing to do. When the person himself or herself knows, I'm going to defend him, and I'm going to make arguments, and I'm going to speak lies, just because of something which I know is not true. So I'm confiding to some person, I'm going to defend him. So then how can I defend someone? So I can imagine a lawyer defending the principle of truth, but defending a principle of untruth, that just seems to be violating this. And not only lawyers, but with anyone, even for us. Asteya, do not steal. And some of these things are very, very subtle. So for example, our sadhumara chalta hoy, and if they pass, for example, just giving a random example, if you're passing by, and in your house, there's a very beautiful rose, then the Acharya Maharaj will know about them. Many sadhu Maharaj do not go and say, let me take a smell of this rose. This rose actually belongs to your property. It does not belong to me. So what right do I have without your consent to even take smell of the flower? So apparently the regulations are pretty broad. But when you go, sukshma ke bada. Sukshma means minute. There are a teacher there, but even karta hoye, every time it comes here. Violation should be of two types. Sukshma or vada. Vada means gross. So we could be gross. Yeah, do not speak lie. Okay, fine, do not say big lies. But now we have small white case of each other. But our Sadhumara point is, these are not the Mahabrats. And the Mahabrats means ultimate. So there is no laxity there. So you want to follow any of these principles to the minutest detail. Okay, yeah, do not steal. Okay, don't steal money from you, don't steal your wallet. But to that extent, they don't even want to smell something. It doesn't belong to me. You're not giving it to me. Why should I take something which is not given to me? The Brahmacharya. And therefore you can now see that Brahmacharya have 9 types data, they don't see to the next place. They want to follow it to the minutest level possible. Aparigraha. Detach themselves from material things, people and places. Aparigraha. And that's again the word. Aparigraha. Where, how does the word come in? Pari means from all sides. Pari means all sides. Like maro parivar suche. Paristhiti, all situations, paristhiti. So the word pari means from all sides. And graha means to acquire. Just acquire. So I want to accumulate everything from all sides. So that's parigraha. A in front of it makes it the opposite. So ahimsa means violence, and ahimsa means non-violence. So parigraha, pari means acquire, pari from all sides, and graha means acquire, and a in front of it means I do not want to acquire anything from all sides. I actually want to detach from all things from everywhere. So, Upadhyaya, detach yourselves from material things, people, and places. Yeah, so Mahavrats for the Satyavrajis and Anuvrats for lay people like us. So, Anu means small. Again, atom, you say, so small. So, those are minor vows. These are the major vows. So, major vows for the monks and nuns, and minor vows for us. Okay, so. So then they also follow the 5 samitis. So we say they are away from the 9 types of celibacy, the Mahabrats, 5 Vrats, but they are 5 samitis. And what are the 5 samitis? Samitis means Gnanacha, Darshanacha, Charitracha, Tapacha, and Viryacha. So they are going to be following, contemplating the knowledge. So they want to increase their knowledge and that of others. Darshanacha, they want to follow the right vision and help others follow it. Charitra, they want to lead a spiritual life and moral life and help others. Thus, follow internal and external austerities, and Viryacha, use their energy for spiritual activities. What's very interesting to know here is it's very correlates to our Namuttanam Aveche. Namuttanam Aveche, Namuttanam Aveche, Namuttanam Aveche, Jinnanam, Javayanam, Pinnanam, Tarayanam, Tuddhanam, Ohayanam, Muttanam, Loganam. Jinnanam means they have conquered. So they're now going to Shikshya. Jinnanam, Javayanam, You know, Pote, they have managed to get liberation and they are helping others to get liberation. Tinnanam. Tinnanam means swim. So they swam across this ocean of life and death and they are helping others overcome this. So not only have they overcome it, but they are helping others. Buddhanam. Buddhanam means they have actually got this knowledge and they are helping Bohoyanam. They are helping others get it. Muttanam Mohakai. Muttanam means mukti. They have got the mukti and they are helping others getting the mukti. So the same thing with the three Guru Maharajis. They themselves are following the right vision and they are helping others following. And that's why we see they are Tetlavadapra Sadhu Maharajis discourses Kriyataje. So many as what they're doing, Upadhyaya Yoga, Vyakhyan Apta Vajje, or YouTube channels Maharajis, starting good quotes. So they're doing all these things. So they want to follow it and they want to help others follow it. So they have got awareness, so no harm is caused. Iriya means vigilance while it's walking. Our Iriya Vyam Sutra Vyam Sutra Vyam Sutra Vyam Sutra Vyam Iriya Vyam Pani Kamami. Chalta chalta. Kind of a big way. So just awareness, so no harm is caused. Bhasa Samiti. So be careful about your body speak. Esa Samiti. Ocean while it's receiving alms. Kumaji Khamu Leva Gyo, then just be careful towards it. Adan Nikshep Samiti. Carefulness. And this is very, very minute. It was quite interesting to know that if somebody is sitting here just by mere observation of you, then you understand what's your frame of mind. And literally you've taken up a spoon from a drawer, and the fact how you even going to shut the drawer, that's what's, sometimes if you're in a lot of aggression, you just shut the drawer. Just like this. So that just shows how much aggression is within you. If you did it very gently, you've taken something out, you slowly put it closer to it gently, that just shows that you are a calm personality. So how careful are you in doing things? Utsat Samiti. Utsat means vigilance while exposing their bodily wastes. So then when Sadhu Maharajis, when they go and sort of when they are, the bodily excretion, they want to be careful of how they do it. But the wider connotation in us is more than they reuse, recycle and reduce. So that's kind of like, some of these concepts we can take in a much more broader concept. Three Guptis. Guptis are always going to be three, mind, vachan, kaya. So you want to see how are you going to restrain your mind, your speech, and your body. So can you see there are three things? Guptis, it's avoidance of negative actions. I don't want to do wrong things with my mind. I don't want to do wrong things with my speech. I don't want to do wrong things with my body. So that's kind of negative connotation. Samitis is progress towards positive actions. I want to be careful doing this. I want to do some kind of more positive connotation. Yeah, that's basically it.
So, I mean, the obvious question is someone like Mario, we didn't have a guru.
So, that's the general criteria. We need Tirthankars. We have 24 Tirthankars, and by definition, a Tirthankar does not have a guru. And their maxim is, search truth for yourself. So what happens is they themselves become self-realized, and then they themselves say that I now actually want to go. So that's why all the Tirthankars, not a single Tirthankar will you see that this was obviously in their past lives they had some like Hokai Mahavir in his 27 previous words, showed some Sadhu Maharaji some way out and he found some good karma. But in that particular lifestyle, none of the Tirthankars will have any gurus themselves. So they are the ones who say, I have renounced the world, I have searched truth myself, I have now then got Kevalgnan because I have got rid of my karmas myself through my own efforts. And once when I got Kevalgnan, and then that becomes a Tirthankar, because now it means that I actually bound that karma, I'm now going to have that fourfold. Okay, I'm going to have sadhus, sadhvis, shavak and shavikas, so I'm now going to start preaching. So Gautam Swami, he got Kevalgnan, he did not start preaching. So the Tirthankars have bound that karma to say, I have now become like kind of Trump, so I've not got the authority to form a religion. So that's what the Tirthankar is. So that's why Namo Arihantanam, Namo Siddhanam. So Arihants, so they are now at the Tirthankars. But by definition, they don't have any gurus. So they search by themselves. And that's why even in meditation, one of the key aphorisms is that Jepan Tame Kidu Hoy, do not take this for gospel. So that's one of the starting point of Jainism. If I say, Batana Ni Khamana, Ani Karwana, okay, you take that, but then you think for yourself. Okay, not that you search truth for yourself, and if it appeals to you, you follow. If it doesn't appeal to you, then you say, yeah, this something is wrong. So therefore, the blind following actually goes away. Okay, someone can show you the path, but then he says, please start using your intellect and speak, make your decision. And so therefore, even the whole concept of karma is anyone that keeps it in the game. No, you use your brain. If I told you jump and I have to curve, you have to think. If I tell you to jump, is this something, you're telling something right or wrong. So the whole onus and the whole form of spirituality in Jainism is on the self.
But once you have a guru, you follow them almost blindly or not.
But that's again the condition. So you got that faith at every stage that this guru, whatever he's going to tell me, is going to be for my own benefit. And this guru is indeed a true guru. So there is never ever going to be an instance whereby this guru is going to be doing something. It's almost like you're going to your doctor. You go to your doctor, and if you got the utmost satisfaction, if this doctor made it committed again, and as you know in medical field, even the doctor could give you a placebo. Okay, it's got nothing, but because of your absolute blind faith in the doctor, you will actually get cured. So as long as you know that the guru, but if the guru then starts swaying and you start saying, okay, our guru is the but however that the guru is now, you know, having a luxurious lifestyle, the food and having affairs and all this kind of stuff, they say, is this now really now getting to the right side? Is this guru guru? So then that is always there. So if you know, okay, I'm a guru chit, then it's and then again sometimes you have to sometimes feel, because the gurus are actually in a much different level of mindset than us. So for example, without any other, so for example, you could have a guru with having a lot of splendor around here. Then you want to see Rakhi Vidhi again. So guru says, sometimes when I've seen certain gurus, and question begs my friend, when I'm asked the question, what it seems is, you know, as a guru, I am Vitra. I'm trying to follow the path of Vitra. So you know, the money I take with failure situations or the crap situations, I'm away from it. But I think if you have got so much reverence, oh, Amar Guruji, Munimani special Kursi Kariyapu, Munimani special Kariyapu, it's your devotion which is doing that. But it's this, if the Guru is actually not swayed by it, then in a way it doesn't make much of a difference. Guru says, I'm actually beyond that. You actually give me a throne to sit like a king's throne, I'll sit on a king's throne. If you can make me sit in a mud ear, I'll sit in a mud ear. I'm actually indifferent. But that's a very internal thing which for external eyes you cannot see. Yeah, Guru ne, Munimani, king's throne, you might actually be feeling quite great. You go, wow, Kikumane, look at my devotees here, they actually giving me a throne to sit on. And next day, you can be sick of it, and if you're equally, as equal, you don't have any, then you're clearly need a true guru. But with external eyes, that's very difficult to know.
I've seen a few gurus on their throats, I've never seen one in a month.
Yeah, go to India. But I think it's quite relevant to say, that apne jara Panchindiya Sutra ave chhe. And this really made me think quite a little. If you look at all of us here, right, we are trying to say that we are trying to be good citizens, good human beings. Yet, every single one of us would have some flaws. Without doubt. Okay. Whether it's seen externally or internally. Right? So, after Guru Maharaj is not that we are still in such a day and age where there might be slight minor flaws in some of the gurus, because none of the gurus would be absolute epitome of perfection. So in that way, we just because of some minor flaws, we cannot say I'm going to corrupt you. Because if I saw a slight flaw in you, I can say, oh, he's really a bad person. Okay, yeah, I know you're human, you might have slight flaws here, yeah, but that's fine, as long as you're controlling it or you're making heaven. So I think we need to be very careful about how going to corrupt you. I actually, my personal feeling is, no matter what the rules are, they're actually frustrated enough because they're doing so much more hardships and going through so many of these other things which we are not able to follow themselves. So, all the credit to them. The hardships, they go through the hunger, so they go through many things which is quite difficult for us to follow. So, I think all due reference to all rules, unless obviously some of them are actually blatantly disregarding the major.